And then there are some standard value of 5QI, which we will just discuss. So this is the content, and I'll try to cover this in a less than an hour. Slightly, it may be here and there, but I have planned it for 45 to 50 minutes. So the presentation is actually based on 3GPP specification 23.501. So this is in a specification which gives system architecture for 5G system. This is taken from release 16 itself. So most of the terminology and the words I have taken from this, but the figures or infographics I have taken from some of the white papers, and there are certain blog and articles onto the internet I have taken from that. So let me start from the basic 5G architecture. So if you look at the 5G architecture, we have onto this diagram. So onto the lower side, if you see, this is a kind of user equipment, which may be a mobile device or it may be any other kind of device. Then we have radio access network, so we call it G node B in case of 5G. And then we have user plane function, a UPF, which allows all the data traffic to go towards the data network. In 5G, we call it data network because it's not only packet data, it could be even structured data. In 4G, it used to be only packet data, but in 5G, it supports even unstructured, structured data also. That is, will be used perhaps for even IoT. On the upper side, we have network function, control network function. So the important control network function here is the AMF, that is access and mobility function. We'll talk about that in the upcoming slide. We have session management function, policy and charging function. We have authentication function. And then we have network slice selection functions, which selects the network slice, because in 5G, we have a concept of network slicing, which we'll be discussing. And then we have UDM, Unified Data Management, where subscriber profiles are actually stored. So that also we'll talk about. And then we have network exposure function, which is a gateway for any third-party applications to connect to the 3GPP network. Even OSS and BSS would be connected through the NEF. And then we have a network repository function, which is nothing but it contains a kind of address of all the network element, and all other network element actually discover the other network element for communicating with that through the NRF. And they use API kind of connections, so application programming interface. So it is not point to point connection, which used to be up to 4G network. It is a kind of API now. So the discovery of a network element would be required. For example, if a new AMF instance is kind of deployed, so normally its address will be registered here, and then other network element, if they want to communicate, they will discover it through the NRF. And then we have a internet. So all those other services will be called application function, and it will be kind of become part of the 5G, and will be on the same. So those application function, which is kind of being offered by the same operator, will be part of the same 5G core network, or it could be outside this, and then it will connect through the NEF. If you look at the lower side, so this is called user plane, because all the data traffic from a mobile device or any user equipment to the G node B, and then it goes to the user plane function, and then to the data network. So in 5G, the most important aspect is that they have completely separated user plane and the control plane. Up to the 4G network, this was also one of the requirement, and they tried to do it, but some of the network function which were there as part of user plane were also doing some control function, like serving gateway and function, but they were also having certain control plane functions. So, but in 5G, it has been completely separated out. And because it has been separated out, now this, the user plane part can be, so for example, UPF and all can be actually deployed near to the user or near to the G node B, so that latency requirement and other requirement is met. So now traffic is not required to go to the core and then again come back, because the entire user plane is kind of a separated. Upper part, as I said, is the control plane, so that it can be deployed on a cloud environment anywhere, either at one place or more than one location. It could be either a telco cloud, or they can hire from third party, because now all these are not network nodes, which used to be in 4G, 3G and all. These are network function, kind of a software which can run on any commercially off the self hardware. So now there's an opportunity that these network function can be deployed onto telecom, operators cloud or data center, or to a third party cloud. So now, as I said, that user plane is below itself and separated out. So traffic flow, which happens onto the user plane, is called PDU sessions. So protocol data unit sessions. So for every UE, when it registers onto the network, a PDU session is created, and all the data flow happens through the PDU session, which will discuss how this PDU session and quality of service is maintained within the PDU session in the upcoming slide. So before that, I'll just briefly touch upon function of these network elements, so that when we discuss quality of service, it is easy for us to understand. So let us first discuss about access and mobility functions. So if you look at access and mobility functions, so it is kind of equivalent to MME in 4G network, mobility management entity, which was there in the 4G. So what it does is the mobility management. When we say mobility management, basically, so if a UE is there into the network, the AMF will know that if the UE is, say, active, so AMF will know that in which cell a particular UE is present. And if UE is not active at particular moment, so the AMF will at least know that in which tracking area the UE is present. So tracking area is nothing but cluster of cells or G node B, depending upon the user itself. Tracking area gets defined by the network. So the mobility management is one function. And then when a user move from one G node B to other G node B, the AMF is the same AMF would continue to serve that particular user. And other is the access management. So if you recall, in our earlier session, we had talked about that in case of a 5G, when initial registration happens, so it do not send its kind of SUPI, subscription identification, but rather it encrypts and then it sends. So at that point of time, the AMF is one which kind of plays a critical role in such access management. And also it allocates the temporary ID to the UE, so that which we call it GUTI, a globally unique temporary ID, which is allocated by AMF to every UE, and that temporary ID is frequently changed. So all those management is actually done by AMF, of course, in coordination with the UDM and other authentication server, etc. And of course, registration, initial registration, I talked about that during initial registration, AMF plays a key role. So these are the basic function of AMF, and as it does security, because encrypted SUKI comes and it gets decrypted in the core, so it plays a role in the security also. Now moving to the second network element, that is SMF, which is session management function. So as the name suggests, that the session management, so the creation of a PDU session, protocol data unit session, is actually done by SMF. And if there is a requirement, modification to that PDU session is also done by SMF. And at the end, it has to be closed. So tear down of the session is also kind of done by SMF. So So all those PDU session connectivity which we saw, that PDU session is nothing but a series of connection from UE to G node B to UPF and then to the data network. So all those connections are managed by SMF, which it instructs to those elements to connect a PDU session for a UE. And as the data traffic has to flow through the UPF, so which UPF has to serve a UE, the selection of UPF is also done by the SMF, depending upon the location of the user and also what kind of service it want to take. So out of various instances of UPF, SMF selects a particular instance, relevant particular instance of UPF. So that is the function of session management function. Now, coming to UPF itself, user plane functions. So if you look at UPF, so basically, as I said, the entire data traffic flows through the user plane functions. So all those packet routing and forwarding towards data network and also back in the downlink direction is done by user plane function. And in case a UE moves from one G node B to other G node B, or even from one cell to other cell within the G node B, the UPF is same. So UPF become kind of an anchor point during intra and inter RAT mobility. RAT is radio access technology, which is G node B in our case, as 5G supports any kind of access. So that's why they write RAT, any kind of access technology they can support. And then since the UPF is sitting onto the user plane, so enforcement of quality of service flows and the policy related aspect is actually taken care by UPF practically. Although it will get kind of a command or instruction from SMF, but the actual enforcement is done by UPF itself. And of course, the UPF has to connect to the SMF, because all those instructions, when we discuss quality of service, we'll understand that the instruction actually comes from the SMF, which is session related aspect, and it follows or complies to those instructions. So now after that, let us go to the policy and charging function. So as the name suggests, all those dynamic policy decisions depending upon at a particular moment, what are the condition in the network and what are the requirement, all those policy decisions are taken by policy and policy control function. So basically, for example, if the resources are not available, so whether a particular service is to be allowed or not is decided by PCF, and that it conveys to SMF, and then it goes to the user plane function itself. So that's a command chain which happens. Or in case if a particular speed has to be throttled, so that decision is also done by PCF. So basically, it can alter mobility and the session related service aspect. So all those policy decisions are taken by PCF. And for all the quality of service related aspect, all those rules which is provided to G node B and to UPF and also to the user equipment actually comes from the PCF as a PCC rule to SMF, and then SMF finally sends this to these three elements. This we'll be discussing in detail while discussing the QoS flow. And the PCF actually connects to SMF, and this is not UFF, UDM, I think it's a typing mistake from my side, sir. And it also connects to the data network. So now let us talk about other network element very briefly. So as I said, unified data management is a kind of repository of all the user information. So kind of a subscriber data similar to HLR, it is there, and it also contains data network profile. When I say data network profile, here there could be many data networks getting connected to the 5G. Through the user plane, because it could be IMS, it could be internet data, or it could be AR/VR service, it could be any other kind of V2X kind of service which connects through the UPF. So the profile of those data networks are also contained by UDM, and a particular subscriber, whether he is or that particular user is allowed a particular data network or not, is also is there in the UDM. And it also plays a very important role in security and access authorization. If you recall, during initial registration, when the SUPI comes in an encrypted way, which is encrypted through a public key, so the decryption is done by UDM itself, because the private key is held here in the UDM and it can only decrypt, and then it converts back into SUPI and sends to the AMF. So all the security and access authorization related function UDM does, and of course it will play a part in registration and also in the mobility management, because all the profiles of a customers are maintained here, so whether a customer is allowed mobility or not, all those information should be there with the UDM. So now going to the application function, I just said that there could be many application functions connected to the 5G network. So any of the application function which is connected to 5G will have two part. One part would be near to the UPF, and the control part would be near to the core, and it will connect to the core through NEF, network exposure function, which I just explained earlier. And so what happens, suppose a particular UE want to access a service which is offered by application functions. So the application functions connects to the PCF for informing the charging related information and other rules. So it connects to even the core network function like PCF for policy framework and policy control. And then AUSF is authentication server. So this is a kind of authentication service. It used to be even in 4G networks. Network exposure function, I discussed that this is to connect the third party applications like AF or even OSS, BSS, or suppose some data, anonymized data is to be collected, it will be connecting to NEF onto the API, and those data can go. NRF, I said, this is a repository function, network repository function. So whenever a new network element is started onto the core network, actually it first registers itself into the NRF. So it gives its IP address and URL kind of. And when other element want to actually interact with that network elements, they first discover that into the NRF, and then they can connect to. And NSSF is network slice selection function. So there'll be n number of network slices supporting different services. So the core network would be logically divided into multiple network slices, and each slice can support a particular usage scenario. Suppose slice one is supporting enhanced mobile broadband, slice two may be supporting V2X kind of application, or slice three may be supporting IoT devices and all. So there could be n number of slices. There could be a slice for a corporate. So suppose NTI PRIT want a separate slice onto the 5G network for all across the country for its officers. So one can hire that through an operator, and that could be a separate slice. So now coming back to PDU session and quality of service flow, where we said we have user plane, control plane. Onto the user plane, we have PDU session. So if you look at a PDU session, so whenever initial registration takes place at that point of time, and whenever later on when UE want to use data, so a PDU session is created for it, and this PDU session is nothing but series of connection from UE to Z node B to UPF to the relevant data network. So a PDU session is actually unique to a particular UE. So a PDU session will not be shared between multiple UE, but a PDU session will actually contain. So there may be a requirement of different kind of traffic. So a UE may be accessing one or more than one service, and every service may require a different kind of quality of service requirement. So every type of traffic or IP flow which is coming from UE or in a downlink direction is actually assigned a quality of service flow ID. So QFI we call it. So every QS flow ID will be given an ID, say QS flow ID 1. And there can be more than one QoS flow. So for example, onto a mobile somebody is using a browser, so there'll be a QS flow or default QS flow for the browsing kind of application. If parallelly it may be accessing some other service, maybe video conference or audio call, etc. So for every such different call, there may be a different quality of service requirement. So there'll be multiple QoS flow within the same PDU session. So if an UE is having one PDU session, it can have n number of QoS flows. So QoS flow is the kind of a lowest granularity in 5G, which supports quality of service requirement. So the a particular QoS flow can be established, and if need be, later on other QoS flow can be added onto the same PDU session. So this is the concept in 5G. So just to summarize till now, that after registration, a default PDU session is established, and every PDU session would be unique to a particular UE, and quality of service is enforced at QoS flow level, which is the lowest granularity in 5G. And kind of each QoS flow packet would be classified and marked a particular QFI, depending upon what kind of quality of service is required for a particular IP flow. Certain QFI will be assigned having meeting those quality of service requirement. And a UE can have multiple QoS flow, as shown in the diagram, within the same PDU session. So now let us see so how the architecture of quality of service is there in the 5G. So if you look at this diagram, so the leftmost part is UE, that is the mobile device or any kind of user equipment. And the middle part is the radio part, which is G node V in case of 5G. So it could be any other radio access technology. And then we have user plane function. So onto the user plane, we have UE, G node V, and UPF. And then beyond this, there'll be a data network where it may gets connected. So if you look at this yellow diagram, so yellow figure, it is this is representing a PDU session. And within the PDU session, I have QoS flow 1, QoS flow 2, and QoS flow 3. So there could be n number of QoS flow. Onto the radio side, from UE to G node B, onto the radio side, what happens is that there's a concept of data radio bearer. So DRBs are the radio resources, so which is kind of allocated. So one, if you look at this DRB, this is containing two QoS flow. That means one DRB can actually contain more than one QoS flow. Similarly, if you look at QoS flow 3 here, so there is a separate DRB where QoS flow 3 is running. So within the PDU session, I have three QoS flow, which is managed by two sets of DRB. But if you go beyond G node B towards UPF, so this is not a one-to-one mapping, so DRB to this place, but there is a common tunnel for a particular PDU session. So within a PDU session, for a PDU session, a common tunnel is created, which is called a GTP tunnel, GPRS, it uses GPRS tunneling protocol, where these QoS flows is kind of transmitted. But these QoS flows are identified because they'll have a respective flag and headers, wherein these are actually identified, and a respective QoS parameter can be actually maintained. So this is kind of a 5G QoS architecture, which is there in the 5G. So let me discuss it further in the upcoming slide. So this is different from 4G. 4G, if you look at 4G architecture, there's a one-to-one mapping from DRB to other places, because there you have serving gateway, then you have PDN gateway, and then you have data network. So from each element, there is a one-to-one mapping, wherein in 5G here, we have a common tunnel for a particular PDU session, but DRB could be separated depending upon the requirement of quality of service. And as I said, one DRB can contain one or more QoS flow. So now, how many types of QoS flow which 5G supports? So it supports quality of service flow with GBR, that is guaranteed bitrate. So it supports some of the quality of service where bitrate has to be guaranteed. For example, if it is a voice call, IMS based voice call, that has to be guaranteed. A particular bitrate has to be guaranteed. It also supports the QoS flow with NGBR, which is non-guaranteed bitrate kind of service. And then it also supports delay critical GBR, wherein for applications like URLLC, ultra reliable low latency kind of communications, for example, V2X or self-driving car or remote surgery, all those applications would require delay critical GBR kind of quality of service, wherein a particular set of data or volume of data has to be received within a defined packet delay budget. So that's why we call it delay critical GBR. And the fourth type is called reflective QoS. So this was not there in the 4G. So this is a new kind of QoS. So what happens, the UE, depending upon or based upon what were the QoS parameter in the downlink direction, so UE does mapping on same kind of QoS flow or the QFI in the uplink direction also. So this is called reflective QoS, which we'll be discussing in slide detail in upcoming slides. So up till now, whatever I discussed, this is just a summary that each UE can have one or more PDU sessions. In the diagram, it appears that one UE can only have one PDU session, but an UE can have more than one PDU session. And for a PDU session, there'll be at least one data radio bearer. There could be more than one DRB, but at least one DRB has to be there on which default QoS flow would always be there. And additional DRBs are allocated whenever there is a QoS flows within the PDU session, which requires more DRB. So that is allocated as and when required. And those different quality of service flows are assigned onto the different DRB. So there may be a default QoS flow which may have one DRB, and guaranteed bitrate may have other DRB. So it is allocated as per the requirement. And as I said, it supports guaranteed bitrate, non-guaranteed bitrate, delayed critical GBR, and also the reflective QoS. So I wanted to explain in bit detail that how the QoS flow mapping happens at different levels. So it is the same diagram in a slightly detail. So onto the left side, I have the user equipment. It could be a mobile or it could be any other kind of device. In the middle, I have G node B, so air interface here. And then here I have user plane function. So let me discuss the downlink side of a traffic when some traffic is in the downlink direction. So what happens? So here, what is seen, shown here is that there may be a best effort kind of service, maybe browsing. There may be a WhatsApp video, there may be a Skype video, there may be a YouTube stream. So all these services are browser based services normally, and it will be a kind of an internet protocol data unit. We call it internet PDU. And then I'm showing a Netflix PDU. So Netflix PDU can be treated separately if the Netflix has tied up with an operator and it can support a different quality of service. So here, what it is shown as that it is connected to the 5G network separately. And then we may have a IMS which supports voice and video. So there are three kind of PDUs which is coming in a downlink directions for a particular UE or say more than one UE. So what happens is that at the UPF level, this traffic has to be filtered correctly so that a respective quality of service is applied. For example, if it is an internet PDU, then all these internet traffic would maybe kind of filtered into one, a standard quality of flow is assigned. So for example, here what is said is that the best effort kind of a traffic which is coming can be on a QoS flow ID QFI1, and there are WhatsApp video or Skype which may have slightly different QoS flow. So normally this would also go on to the default, but here it's shown that there'll be some different treatment. And then the Netflix, whatever traffic is coming, is assigned kind of a QoS flow ID 4. And for voice and video, I have a different quality of service flow for voice, this one and that. So this happens through the filtering. We call it SDF filtering, or and then accordingly, these QFI is assigned. And then based on the QFI value, different set of quality of service requirements are taken care onto the tunnel, which is here between GNodeB and UPF, and also onto the radio part. So as I said, there is a common tunnel. When it comes to the GNodeB, now it has to map this traffic onto data radio bearers. So here also, there'll be mapping of, based on the QFI, different traffic would be mapped to the different DRB. What is shown here is that the default QoS, which is coming as a best effort, is given DRB1, and this QFI2 and QFI3, both are given a map to DRB2, and this QoS Netflix is given a separate DRB altogether. Voice and video is also given separate DRB. This is just an example. This will depend upon the configuration, what the operators are doing, depending upon what arrangement they have. And then finally, the UE will be able to again segregate those IP flow and those services the UE will be able to experience. So this was in downlink direction. And similar to the downlink directions, in uplink direction also, whatever IP flows come, so those mapping to the QFI here is done by UE itself, because UE will have some kind of information or the rule, which I'll discuss later in the slide. Based on that, it will map to a QFI at one side, and then it will also map to a particular DRB, which is there onto the radio side. So uplink is similar. And one more thing, so in 5G, in protocol layers of 5G, there is an additional protocol layer is introduced, which is called SDAP, that is Service Data Adoption Protocol, mainly for managing quality of service. And it is between UE and GNodeB here itself. It doesn't go beyond this. The same diagram, this diagram is taken from actually the 3GPP specification document. So so what it is showing is the two-step QoS flow mapping, which I just explained. So if you look at the two terminology which they are using, that mapping here in the UPF to a particular QFI, and mapping here by the user equipment in an uplink direction to a QFI, all those information which these two UE and this element will be getting from SMF, and so that means those signaling is a kind of a NAS signaling. So that's why it is called NAS filter, and mapping to a DRB happens here in the UE and the GNodeB. This is called AS filter, access spectrum filter. So mapping to DRB happens here. As I said, that in 5G, there is a new protocol layer introduced, SDAP, Service Data Adoption Layer, and it handles quality of service in 5G. So this was not there in 4G. 4G was a, that might be being handled at other layers, but it has dedicated layer in 5G. So this is just a summary of what I discussed. So I'll skip instead of repeating that. It is summary of whatever I discussed till now. So I'll just skip this and go ahead. So now let us understand how this default QoS flow works and all, and how these are assigned. So if you look at this example, so this example gives three UE. UE1, UE2, and UE3. So when UE, so let me first discuss what is default QoS flow. So whenever UE registers, or if it is already registered, tries to access data for the first time, So a PDU session is created. So a PDU session is created for a UE. So here I am showing the PDU session here one, and for UE two there is a PDU session, and for UE three there is another PDU session here. So what happens is a default. So what happens whenever there is a PDU session created, there'll be a default QoS flow assigned. So one QFI is already assigned, which is called default QoS flow. And the default QoS flow would be a kind of a non-GBR, non-guaranteed bitrate kind of a QoS flow. So what you see here, this one, this green part is for all the three UEs, just see the green one. So this is a non-GBR default QoS flow, which is assigned at the time of initial registration or whenever it wants to access data. So, and the default parameter for default QoS flow is actually configured by the operator, that what all resource it would be assigned. And then suppose traffic like internet or best effort traffic will continue to be served onto the default QoS flow. There may be a case that the DRB may be assigned more DRB can be assigned, but this will continue to serve till it is a kind of a best effort kind of a service or a normal internet service. Now let us take an example when the PDU session is already connected and there is a default QoS flow, and suddenly UE1 say want to access a video streaming or a audio streaming. So what happens is that now it actually requires a guaranteed bitrate QoS flow. So the default QoS flow was already there, and then onto the default QoS flow, whatever pipe it has got, suppose it want to access a video streaming service. So there'll be application function connected here, which will be providing a service of say video streaming. So the UA will actually connect to the AF and request for that service. So the application function knows that this particular UE is trying to access a video streaming, then it will inform to the PCF policy control function that a particular UE want to access guaranteed bitrate. And then the PCF will actually send instruction to SMF, and then it will go to the UPF and all. And then finally, a guaranteed QoS flow would be assigned. So guaranteed QoS flow would be assigned for that particular UE so that it can have a video streaming service. And then suppose while it is doing video kind of a streaming, and suddenly it also want to use another service which is also a kind of guaranteed bitrate. And at that point of time, again, it reaches out to a particular AF and sends an information that it wants a particular service which is guaranteed bitrate, maybe a AR VR kind of application. So if that application have say same quality of service requirement, then the same within the same PDU session, which is same QoS flow ID which had been created for video streaming, within the same this service data flow will also be carried. So now we have a service data flow for video conference, a service data flow for say ARVR service. If the quality of service requirement are same within the same QFI, which is shown in a pink color here. And if it is a separate QoS requirement, then there'll be a separate, maybe a separate DRB and separate QoS flow would be assigned. But if it is the same, same can carry the traffic. So this is how a guaranteed bitrate QoS flow is assigned. So after discussing that, so now let us talk about little bit the network slices, how QoS flow is managed within a network slices. So as I said that there could be n number of network slices into the 5G network supporting different usage scenarios. So in this example, what is shown is that there are two network slices here. There could be n number, but here, and say network slice one is for service X, maybe a enhanced mobile broadband, and network slice two may be for say ultra reliable kind of a services. And then within a slice, it can support multiple QoS flows. So here, if you see, the slice one is supporting QS flow A and QS flow B, and slice two is supporting, say, QS flow C. So as I said, it could be serving one type of service, so there'll be only one QS flow which will be supported by slice. If it's serving more than one kind of service, then it may have multiple kind of a QS flow support. So, and this quality of service flows, the earlier I discussed about only the radio part and to up to the UPF and then to the data network, but the in between, whatever the transport or the backhaul or the front haul technologies are there, they also need to support all those QS requirement within that. So that is also a requirement. So when we have a 5G network, the QS flow support is required in all the element radio onto the core side and also onto the transport side. So after discussing that, there are many other parameters of quality of service, which I'll be discussing. So how it is structured, let me first explain here, and then I'll just be explaining these parameters. And then in the last, I'll be discussing how various kind of rules are transferred and applied, and how packet filtering is done and all. So these are the QS flow parameter. The first parameter is 5QI. So 5QI is 5G quality of service indicator. So it will have certain characteristics, which is shown here. I'll discuss about that. Then we have allocation and retention priority. Then we have reflective quality of service attribute. Then we have guaranteed flow bitrate, maximum flow bitrate. We have notification control. We have a maximum packet loss rate. These are terminology. In case of a non-GBR flow, these three things are applicable. 5QI, ARP, and RQA. And for GBR flow, all the parameters are applicable. And the 5QI parameters are, what is the resource type, whether it is GBR, non-GBR, what is the default priority label, what is the packet delay budget, what is the packet error rate which it can tolerate, what is the maximum data burst volume, or what is the default averaging window. We'll just discuss about these parameters in bit detail. So let me first go through each of these QS parameter. So as I said, that 5G quality of service identifier is called 5QI. So basically, so every QS flow will be assigned a particular 5QI. And the 5QI, a particular 5QI will have certain parameter which I discussed, that what is the priority label, what is the error rate which it can tolerate, what is the averaging window in which all these calculations are to be done. And then the second is allocation and retention priority, we call it ARP. And it is applied at the service data flow level, those IP flow which I discussed, if it is a, say, YouTube or Netflix, those are SDF. So what happens is that a particular SDF, if it is having a higher allocation and retention priority ARP value, so whenever there is a resource crunch onto the radio, so which particular SDF flow or IP flow is to be admitted and which is to be actually dropped is decided based on the ARP value which it may be associated with. So this is then, as I said, reflective QS attribute. So I a little bit explained that in case of a particular quality of service flow which is coming onto the downlink side, all those parameters UV will be able to decode, and onto the uplink side it will be able to apply those same quality of service requirement. So that is called reflective QS. So all those attribute which is coming part of the packet is called reflective QS attribute or RQA. Generally, it is applicable in the GBR. In some cases, it is applied onto the non-GBR also. And the next is the notification control, which is also very important, that as I said, that 5G supports guaranteed bitrate and also supports non-guaranteed bitrate. So in case of a guaranteed bitrate, if there is a resource crunch and the, say, G node B is not able to provide that kind of quality of service, then it sends a notification to the policy control function that look for this QS flow it is not able to provide the particular set of, say, guaranteed bit rate or any other parameter. And this is this information may be used by PCF for, say, SLA measurement or maybe for charging functions. So those are notified whenever it is there. There may be certain services which is guaranteed bit rate, but those services may be kind of adaptive in the sense that, let me take an example. Suppose it is a video service. So video can actually run on a high definition. It can run on a standard definition. So it can support multiple it can adapt to different requirements. So in such cases, what happens is that whenever a QFI is assigned or given to GNodeB to actually give that, the alternate QS flow requirements are also given, that in case a particular QS flow is not being maintained, that the second alternate is this, third alternate is this, and so on. So what happens when a GNodeB suppose is not able to maintain a quality of service flow, and there is already a alternate QS flow which is given to GNodeB, so it will try to apply the alternate one, and in that case also it will send a notification control that a particular GBR is not possible and it has actually applied an alternate QS flow which was there. So all those notifications are exchanged from GNodeB to PCF, and those are used for say charging function or other SLA kind of measurement. And this happens in a guaranteed bitrate kind of environment only. It is not kind of applicable for non-guaranteed bitrate because that is kind of some kind of best effort basis. And then we have a concept of flow bitrate, and this is applicable for a guaranteed bitrate. So what happens is that in a guaranteed bitrate, so you need to guarantee a particular bitrate. So we call it guaranteed flow bitrate, GFBR. And then, but that is the minimum which a 5G system has to provide. There is also concept of MFBR, which is the maximum flow bitrate. So for a particular GBR, MFBR is also defined. What is the maximum speed or the flow rate which can be given for a particular GBR, because it cannot be unlimited kind of any speed. So both GFBR and MFBR are actually part of those five QI value which we'll talk about. And then there is a concept of aggregate bitrate, and it is for non-GBR kind of, non-guaranteed bitrate kind of, and it is applied on a session basis. So basically it is called session umbers. Umber is aggregate maximum bitrate. So for a particular PDU session of a UE, what is the maximum aggregate maximum bitrate? So when I say aggregate maximum bitrate, it is measured in a particular duration. For a particular duration, what could be the aggregate maximum bitrate which can be allowed? So this is also a parameter which is part of the QS flow. And I had discussed about the certain default values that during the initial registration, default QS flow is added. So what are the value of those parameters are also defined. And then there's a concept of maximum packet loss rate. So how much packet loss can be allowed for a guaranteed bitrate or for a non-guaranteed bitrate is defined in this particular parameter. So now this 5QI has got some characteristics which I'll just be discussing. So those characteristics are, for example, resource type. So it will have these values, that whether it is a GBR type or delay critical GBR or non-GBR type. It will also have a priority level. So what is the priority of this? So suppose two 5QS values are running onto the network, so which one will have priority in case there is a congestion? Better priority kind of. So resource allocation happens in that sense. And also, if there is no congestion, that proportion of resources to be allocated to each 5QI, priority level defines that, sir. And then we have a concept of packet delay budget, so PDB. So basically, within a packet delay budget, so how much data has to actually has to be transferred, and it is more applicable in case of a delay critical GBR kind of applications, wherein within a particular time a certain amount of data has to be definitely transmitted. Otherwise, that particular data will be considered to be lost, and that will be counted as part of packet error rate. So packet error rate is also one parameter which is applicable in both cases, GBR and NGBR, and it gives a value that how much tolerance of a packet error rate is allowed onto the radio side. And the packet delay budget, when we talked, it includes even the core network part from radio and core combined. And this packet error rate is onto the radio side. And then there is a concept of averaging window, that within what, how much duration all these parameters would be measured, all those flow rate and all will be measured. So there is an averaging window concept which is used. And then there is a concept of maximum data burst volume. So this is for delay critical GBR. So what happens is that within a PDB, packet delay budget, the defined maximum data burst rate has to be transmitted. Otherwise, whatever data has not come within that period, those will be considered as lost in case it is a delay critical GBR resource type QoS flow. In case of a non-GBR, it says that 98% of the packet should be coming within the packet delay budget. So there is no concept of maximum data burst volume. There is a concept of percentage in case of a non-GBR, but in case of a GBR, those packets are considered to be lost. So 3GPP has actually defined the standard value of 5QI. So and these 5QI values are, they have defined in such a way that it is kind of a, so in 4G also there were certain parameters equivalent to this. So there has to be some equivalence from the 4G network, because there could be certain roaming scenarios also. So wherein both places some kind of quality of service be maintained. So to the extent possible, they have kept similar values so that mapping would be possible of the QoS flow from 4G to 5G and vice versa. So I'll just take one example. If I take, say, 5QI value 1, so this 5QI value 1 is for, say, voice service, that is normal voice service. So here, if you see, the priority level defined is 20 here, and then the packet delay budget, that how much PDB defined is 100 millisecond. And the packet error rate here is 10 to the power minus 4. And all these parameters would be kind of calculated in an averaging window of 2000 millisecond. And this parameter is for critical GBR, so not applicable. So just see this, and let us compare this with any other. Maybe the next one is the video, live streaming kind of. So here you see priority level is 40. That means if video and voice both are there in the network, priority for voice is more compared to the video. But the packet delay budget is also, like here it is 100 millisecond, but in streaming it has gone up to 150 millisecond. And onto the packet error rate also, I think it is similar, and the averaging window is also same. So there is a slight difference in the priority level and the packet delay budget. And so on. So basically, if you look at, let me take one more. And this I'm talking about guaranteed bitrate resource type at GBR. So all these are guaranteed bitrate. So because voice and video is, it will require guaranteed bitrate. And the third one is the V2X, that is vehicle to anything connection. So here, if you see, a priority level defined is 30. So it is in between voice and video. But here packet delay budget is very, very less, 50 millisecond, because it's a delay critical application. So to some extent, so packet delay budget is less, and the packet error rate is same, and averaging window is same. Now let me go to the non-GBR kind of, and I'll take some examples. So if you go to the non-GBR kind of table, so say 5QI5 is a non-GBR kind of resource type, and is IMS signaling. So there was a voice, and here we have a signaling. So as we see that the 5QI value or the quality of service indicator for voice and its signaling is different, because signaling here, what they say is that it is non-guaranteed bitrate is okay, But the priority level is very, very high, even compared to the voice. Voice was 20, here it is 10. Packet delay budget is same, 100 millisecond. Error rate is also better. There it was 10 to the power minus 4, it is minus 6. So error is also not tolerated compared to voice. It is more stringent, and so here there is no concept of averaging window. So this is for IMS signaling. So now let me go to the delay critical kind of GBR. And one of the application talked here is the discrete automation for industries. So if you look at the parameter, the priority is 19. So better than voice, just better than voice. But the packet delay budget is very, very stringent here. It is 10 milliseconds, very important, right? And the error rate is 24 minus. Fault maximum data burst volume, which is 255 bytes. So what does this means is that within a packet delay budget of 10 milliseconds, if this much data is not received or transmitted, so left out data will be considered as lost, and those will be counted in packet error. So as it is a delay critical, so all these parameters are defined in that way. So these are a standard value 5QI. So as far as possible, the 5G system would use one of the standard 5QI value defined by 3GPP, but specification has also said that in case operator want to have its own kind of, so they can choose these parameters for a particular service requirement, and those are even possible on the fly. The network itself can apply if there is a requirement. Otherwise, in most cases, it will be using the standard value. Now that we have discussed all those parameters, let us understand what is QoS rule, what is QoS profile, and what is SDF template, and how these are assigned onto the network, and which network function does that. So here what I'm saying is that this is again a PDU session, and within the PDU session you have DRB at one side and GTP tunnel on other side, and on that you have two type of QoS flow, QoS flow 1, QoS flow 2. So let us consider one of the QoS flow as a default QoS flow, another QoS flow as a, say, GBR kind of a QoS flow. So now, whenever a UE want to access a data service, as I said, there will be a default QoS flow assigned. And whenever there is a requirement of assigning a other QoS flow, maybe a guaranteed bitrate, so what happens is that when UE connects to the application functions, for example, using the default QoS flow which it has, it will kind of a signal to application function that it want to use the services. And now the application function will actually talk to the PCF and inform about a particular UE want to have a particular GBR service. And then that particular application function will connect to the PCF. And the PCF will know. So now what PCF will do is that PCF will create the PCC, policy control and charging rule, and it will send to the SMF, session management function, because session management function actually interact with Gnode B, UPF, etc. Of course, through AMF, because actually UE has connection N1 interface with AMF. That is a NAS kind of signaling. So the SMF gets all those PCC rule from PCF, and then it creates three things. One is what is creates based on the PCC rule is the QoS rule, QoS profile, and SDF template. So basically the QoS rule and SDF template is some kind of a filter, because all those IP flows in downlink direction here and uplink direction here has to be filtered and applied a certain QFI number, so that a particular aspect or particular requirement of quality of service is provided. So basically it is sending QoS rule to the UE. So UE gets a QoS rule so that it applies the required packet filtering and also the QFI, particular QFI, and it also gets many other parameter which it will be using. For example, you can see the umber, PDU session type, or which is the data network it has to connect to. All those other informations are also there. But for the major part is the packet filtering. So based on these rules, those packet filtering happens for a particular service and particular QFI is assigned so that it is mapped to a particular DRB and further to the this TTPU tunnel. The SMF also sends SDF service data flow template to user plane function for a downlink kind of traffic. So based on the SDF template, whatever IP flows are coming in downlink directions, it filters out and assign a particular QFI based on the requirement of quality of service flow which is defined onto the network. So this way the SDF template is applied and particular QFI is assigned. And the G node B, so gets a QoS profile. So basically QoS profile is nothing but those five QoI value, which I explain: ARP, attention priority, reflective QoS if it is applicable, maximum flow bitrate, guaranteed flow bitrate in case of a GBR, notification control. All these informations are given to the G node B by the SMF, and then accordingly it applies or allocates the resources like DRB and all. So this is how QoS rule, QoS profile and SDF template is applied to different network element to maintain a particular quality of service. So this is the last slide where I just wanted to compare the quality of service which is there in 4G and quality of service which is there in the 5G. So if you look at quality of service in 4G, where you have user equipment, then you have E node B, then you may have serving gateway, then you have PDN gateway, and then you have the internet or the packet data network. So here on the radio, here also it is data radio bearer, but in this, between these two, they call it S1 bearer, and then they call it SS/SB bearer. So basically there is a one-to-one mapping end-to-end 4G. So, but whereas in 5G, onto this side there is a single tunnel. So although here it is a data radio bearer, different data radio bearer, but the this N3 tunnel is a single tunnel supporting the entire PDU station. It is a PDU station base. One PDU station will have one tunnel, whereas it is completely separate. Each of the kind of SDF or the QoS flow will be different. So what are the different attributes which is equivalent to 4G and 5G? So the quality of service identifier in 5G, we saw that it is five QI value, those QoS identifier, where in 4G, it used to be called QoS class and identifier. And the IP data flow here, we call it QoS flow. In the 4G, it is called EPS bearer. And the bearer identifier, here it is the QFI, the quality of service flow ID, which is defined to each QoS flow, where it is the EPS bearer ID, EBI. And in 5G, we have a concept of reflective QoS, which was not there in 4G. And the data session, we call it the protocol data unit session. There we used to call it PDN sessions. This is the difference. So with that, sir, session is over, sir. So we may have your feedback and suggestions, sir. Sir.
It's a very good presentation.
Thank you, sir. Sir.
Wonderful.
Sir.
Can we add something about